as you are aware of, it's Evan's big day with a trial lecture first, but then it's a big day for the committee, so we will actually hear their trial lectures as well. And then we will have the big battle and the interesting defense at 1:15, continued with an Indian dinner at Sunday's place. In between, we will celebrate up in the sixth floor. But we very much look forward to hear what Adam's take on the title he was given. We had 2 weeks to prepare, Platforms and Ecosystems for Health Information Systems Development. And that should be very relevant for all of us. So, it's all yours.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. I have the pleasure to talk about Platform and Ecosystem for Health Information System Development. So during this presentation, I will give a brief definition of platform and ecosystem and health information system. I will provide the managerial and technical perspective on platform and ecosystem. Talk about the critics of this perspective, and then describe, give or provide some examples of HIS. And see in light with this perspective, what are the challenges? Suggest an alternative approach and give some example of DHS2 platform evolution, and then provide concluding remarks. So, what is a platform? Oxford English Dictionary has described a platform as a raised level surface which provides which people or things can stand, on which things or people can stand, usually a discrete structure intended for a particular activity or operation. Whereas an ecosystem is seen as a biological system composed of all the organisms found in a particular physical environment, interacting with it and with each other. In terms of business, an ecosystem is defined as a large number of loosely interconnected entities which rely on each other for their collective survival and effectiveness. So how platform has been defined from the managerial and technical perspective? For Tijuana, for instance, the platform is an extensible software-based product or service that serves or that provides core functionalities shared by apps that interoperate with that platform. And an ecosystem or platform ecosystem is defined as a collection of platforms and apps that interact with it through standardized interfaces. So for example, we have Apple's iOS with its over millions of apps. We have Android's, Google Chrome with its extensions, and so forth. So here we have a picture of an ecosystem in its environment. And as you can see here, we have first, in the ecosystem, we have a shared infrastructure that is used by both the platform and apps that interact through standardized interfaces. And besides the ecosystem, we have also competing ecosystem. And outside the ecosystem, we have end users who, together with all the competing ecosystems, form an environment. And of course, one end user can interact with one or more than one ecosystem. And in that case, we'll be talking about multi-homing. So what drives the migration towards platform ecosystem? First of all, the increasing demand for more specialization instead of homogeneous product or services are driving this process. There is also the digitization of product activity, process, or service. The embedding also of routine business process activity into software product are also contributing to this process. And we have also the growth of the Internet of Things, where we have appliances or many devices being able to communicate to each other via the network. And as a platform of all these driving forces mentioned above, we have the available, the omnipresence of wireless network that is enabling this data exchange, also the processing of business activities and processing in the electronic manner. So what are the characteristics of platform ecosystem in this managerial and technical perspective? The first characteristic is that the platform ecosystem or ecosystem has a complex evolution, meaning that what has been observed over a period of 30 years in other industry is now being observed in a period of about 5 to 7 years. And for the platform ecosystem, their evolution predicts their survival, meaning that the platform or the ecosystem has to evolve fast to keep alive. And Tiwana has referred to this as the red queen effect by analogy to the fairy tale about Alice. There is also the need for the platform owners to be able to harness external disruptive innovations that are happening outside the ecosystem. So it's supposed that the platform owners will throw the brain power of the hungry entrepreneurs who want to innovate and succeed in the market. So mix this brain power with that motivation and then get new product or services that the market will select as innovation. So the market will be selecting the winners or the losers in this ecosystem. And then there is also three inseparable gears of the evolution engine of the ecosystem. The first one is the architecture itself. So the architecture here provides the ability. That ability comes from the fact that the architecture is supposed to be flexible and modular with standardized interfaces that give the ability to app developers to come develop their own system in a modular manner with the concept of encapsulation and being able to interact with the platform through this standardized interface. But again, this architecture in itself is a technical choice but has a very important strategical implication. And that's also posed the challenge for both the IT people and the business people, because the IT people are good in designing or making IT architecture, but they are not very expert in strategy, whereas the managers are good in strategies, but are very don't know much about technical choices. And it's also supposed that the architecture of an ecosystem has two parts. You have the core composed of the platform itself, which is relatively stable, and we have variable peripheral components, which are the apps. The two other gears are the governance and strategy. So it is said that having the ability that is provided by the architecture itself is not good enough to make something or to achieve innovation. But having the motivation alone also without ability cannot lead to anything. So the governance and strategy are providing this motivation in complement, that will complement the ability. So it's believed that combining ability with motivation, people can then, using their ability with their motivation, can do the development. So the governance and strategy are about decision rights, the control which type of control, and also the pricing policies. And of course, the pricing policies also will regulate the motivation for people. I mean, if someone see that by joining this ecosystem, if he will get some incentives through the pricing policy, then he can join and develop. And it's also said that both the governance and the strategy should also evolve according to the life cycle of the system. And for instance, at launch, the platform owner may be, for instance, permissive or be less permissive in terms of participation, but more permissive in terms of behavior so that people can come and explore the platform and innovate. While at a later stage, at maturity, for instance, it could be the opposite. In terms of generativity is seen in the managerial and technical perspective on ecosystem as not being an attribute of a team. It is instead seen as the outcome of interaction between knowledgeable people with a flexible IT. And there's also an emphasis on the concept of economy of scope in production and in innovation, meaning that the cost of jointly producing or developing a product is less than the cost of developing them separately. There is also an emphasis on the role of the market in selective innovation, as I said, the linear through mass adoption. And lastly, there is the notion of network effect, which refers to the degree to which or the extent to which any additional user joining the system will make it more valuable for each existing user. So here, using all these characteristics, I provide this conceptualization of a generative platform ecosystem, where you have the architecture, governance and strategy, and knowledgeable people combined together through this interaction will lead to a generative platform ecosystem. So, what are the critics of this perspective? First of all, if we recall the definition or the picture we have seen here, the end users are excluded from this definition. And still in terms of definition, it has been also said that a platform is not necessarily a software product. It can be even a published platform, a published standard. And this perspective lacks an account on the complex relationship between people, technology, their interests, politics, culture, and so forth. And the role of market is also overstated. And it has been said by Big Sam, for instance, that innovation in a platform environment or innovation does not necessarily diffuse to mass adoption, because in the context of platform ecosystem, what is driving innovation sometimes is the need for specialization. So that specialization can only maybe address the need of a small group. So if that innovation concerns only that small group, then this innovation cannot necessarily diffuse, but will effectively serve that small niche. In terms of architecture, the relationship platform and complement is not necessarily a fixed relationship. What is the platform today combined with its complement could be the reverse in another context. And that has been described by Sahel et al. As the two strategy where the platform can be reconfigured according to the politics or the context to market themselves. And also it has been said that the platform architecture itself is not that stable as thought in the managerial perspective. The architecture may be also changing in time, because the architecture that will enable the start or the kickoff of the platform or the ecosystem may not be necessarily the same at maturity. In terms of generativity, the way generativity is conceived in this perspective lack also an account on this socio-technical perspective on generativity, where it is known that generativity can be socially, can be technically or socio-technically enabled or constrained. And this perspective does not also address the issue of capacity development, because it supposes that knowledgeable people with their business can just interact with the platform and then come and develop, whereas there is a need to, in some cases, to develop capacity for people in order to come and interact with the platform, but also to develop content. In terms of innovation, this perspective has a very narrow focus on innovation. Innovation is mainly seen as belonging to IT domain, whereas it is known that innovation can be also outside the IT domain in an ecosystem. And of course, this also related to the way they see the platform itself. And innovation is not only in the hands of app developers. Innovation is also created through a complex interaction between developers, end users, and other actors. And of course, as in the case of generativity, you have also many factors that can constrain or favor innovation. And finally, the relationship in this perspective between app developers and users is merely seen as a user-buyer relationship. So now, given this managerial and technical perspective on platform and ecosystem, let's now come back to health information system. In general, health information system has been defined as or described as fragmented, both in developed countries and in developing countries. And if you look at, for instance, at hospital level, we have electronic medical records, lab information system, we have PACS, we have pharmacy systems. And in the particular case of USA, for instance, we have nearly the same issue of fragmentation as in developing countries, where they are pushing for electronic medical records, for instance, through this high-tech initiative with Medicare, where there are a lot of regulations and incentives put in place for clinicians to use electronic medical records to improve service delivery, quality of service delivery to people. But still, there are still some problems that are also observed in some developing countries. And I think it was also the level of the quality and the level of use of this EMR system has been also assessed according to three levels, similar to what we have in our community here as tally sheet, classifying this at three levels. And in the US, I think in most of the cases, they were at level one. And many clinicians are even complaining about being distracted by the emphasis on the IT system instead of using or doing their traditional practices, focusing on how to better provide care to their patients. So, this is a brief overview of these two countries. Maybe it's also worth to say that in addition to this factor, we can also talk about some external mediators. In the developed countries, we have market mechanism, we have regulations also. But in developing countries, we also have regulations. But in addition to that, we have something which is particular, meaning the the role of development partners. I will come back to it later. So now, given this context of HIS, I will now provide the description of two cases of health information system in two countries that I know very well. So if you look at Mali, for instance, in terms of system, we have DHS2 dealing with aggregate reporting data, but also dealing with individual reporting, with tracking of patients in case of communicable diseases, or to follow the immunization of children. We have also human resource information system, which is interoperable with DHS2, but is not up to date. We have logistic management information system, which deals with stock inventory and stock indicator, but not interoperable with DHS2, which is seen as the backbone or the platform in this environment. We have some electronic medical record system in a handful of hospitals. We have metadata registry, which is not up to date and not interoperable. We have MHERO, which is a kind of interactive SMS messaging to assess the capacity of health workers and also to inform them in case of emergency outbreak and so forth. We have also the WHO regional database. In terms of actors, we have at country level, we have the Minister of Health, we have health programs, users, we have donors, we have providers in terms of network providers, we also have software providers, we have system implementers, developers, and so forth. And at international level, we have WHO, we have Global Fund, WHO, HIS, UNICEF, UNFPA. And Senegal is more or less the same situation as in Mali. So given this brief description of the cases of Mali and Senegal, why this system will not take on the managerial and technical ecosystem perspective characteristics? If you look at the definition, by excluding the end users from the ecosystem, we risk to sideline these end users by, we need to get these end users being sidelined by technology or being left out of development, which is the opposite of the aim of bringing this ecosystem to strengthen or to develop the health information system. And also, in this context, most systems are pilots. They are not on full scale, and they are not updated. So relying heavily on making this interoperability between apps and a platform to leverage on what each system have, or also to benefit from the network effect, might not necessarily work, because to benefit most from this interoperability, each system has to be on full scale, up to date, and up and running. Otherwise, this effort will be misleading. And it's also known that interoperability is not an end, it's just a mean. And the most important thing is the maturity of the information used in the system. So if there is no maturity of information used in the system, even if we bring interoperable systems, then it won't lead to anything. In this context, we have also the important role played by donors who interfere with this process, trying sometimes to promote their own interests. And sometimes we also have redundancies, meaning that we have parallel systems. But these parallel systems are there because of many reasons. Sometimes when they come as a